They used to call her Violent Violet. And it was, you know, the acerbic nature of some of the smaller pieces or some of the chamber music. And one of the things that I, in some ways, discourage is, you know, don't play those pieces to start with. But for the average listener, I mean, the piece that had the most profound impact on me that I heard was the bells, the cantata. When I heard that, you know, I just went, whoa, this is the violet I've never seen before or never heard before. Piece like that allows a composer to really express themselves in a completeness, whereas all those little works, it's an idea, and the novice listener will only get a small picture of a bigger person looking through one of those little pieces. And I think, you know, you got to start with the big ones. Beethoven is known for his big pieces. We learn his little pieces because we know his big pieces. And I think with somebody like Violet, her big pieces, I mean, Scannarelli, her opera, is this incredibly comic, wonderful romp through the operatic world. And that's Violet, you know, thinking on a bigger plane than she was when she was doing the smaller things. There's so much functionality in the smaller pieces. I mean, it is that Hindemith training, the Gebrauchmusik. And the sonatas and that, well, they're wonderful and they're good things. I don't know, I like the bigger ones better.
Of the 60s and 70s, well, 50s, 60s, and 70s, that period of time when people kind of lumped all music together in that term avant-garde. Violet was never an avant-gardist. If you sort of listen fresh, you'll actually find that her music is so much tamer than everybody else's. They, around here in Alberta, they referred to her as Violent Archer, often with a kind of affection for that, but also it revealed the fact that they were hearing what they considered to be avant-garde at that time, you know. But times have passed, and this is a time in which that whole modernist thing is gone, and everyone's trying to communicate. And here was a composer whose every note was an attempt to communicate from the deepest part of her soul outwards.
If I'm really conscious of tailoring what I'm writing, but I'm terribly conscious of the idea that what I'm doing should project, you see. And the result is that maybe in my own subconscious I am tailoring it, you know. But I can't say that I would consciously do it that way. It's just that I have the desire to communicate. In all of my compositions that I do, I've never felt, oh, well, I'm writing this piece, but I don't care a rap if anybody wants to hear it except me. I don't feel that way, you see. I don't think that is a positive approach to art. I think that it should be something that one needs to establish a contact with other human beings. Thank you.
Well, I'm absolutely convinced that she just passionately loved music. I'm also convinced that she had a profound love for humanity, a desire to communicate to it. She felt herself to be placed on this planet for a reason, and she was fulfilling that, her gifts, her talents. I think probably like most artists, there was a bifurcation somewhere in her soul. She was divided from the world, and so driven to create, like most composers, driven to create a world that is better than the one in which one lives. And that comes from some source of pain. I'm not privy to that knowledge, but I could well imagine that that's a part of it.